Hey, sweet. All right. Hopefully things are gonna crash less now on this stream. Songbringer Day 259. Still working on data-driven stuff. Programming mostly today in today's stream. Welcome everyone. Welcome, welcome, welcome. What's up, Arcane? You been, man? Where was I here? Oh, that's right. I was creating all these new methods for creating entities. Really basic methods. But something messed up with the enemies. All the enemies are now just, they won't do anything. They refuse to take action, even if you hit them. Wonder what state they're in right now. It looks like they don't have a behavior. Oh, that's what it probably is. So, the new methods are up here. It creates an entity. It can create entities so many different basic ways. Ah, school, huh? Yeah. How have I been? Oh, so great, dude. Things are going great. There's an Indie Cup competition that I'm gonna be part of with Songbringer in December. So December 10th, Songbringer is gonna be competing with like 30 other games at this event. So I'm pretty stoked for that. And what's new to the game is lots of there's you can move diagonally. There's four buttons instead or four yeah four buttons for items instead of two. And I'm getting things prepared, so there's gonna be a lot more gating and cooler overworld with so like you'll be able to like the player will be able to stay within a certain area until you gain like traversal items, sort of like Metroid inspired. Items that basically, for example, the sword is a very simple item that could get you through like a grow back tile or whatever. Bombs could get you through a bombable rubble or something like that, you know? Braces, huh? Right on. Wow. I had braces for 6 years, man. How long do you have to have them? Yeah. Oh, Cobblane, yeah. Yeah, Kyle Blaine was one of the primary proponents of saying, hey, it should have diagonal movement. But yeah, let me show you that, actually. The enemies are broken right now, but yeah, I'll play with my Xbox controller so you can see the diagonal movement. It's best for that because you get the, when you have that analog stick, it really is awesome for diagonal movement. Not to say the Super Nintendo controller isn't as awesome too, but yeah, all right. So yeah, all the enemies are broken right now, but so yeah, you can move diagonally, and with an analog stick, you can move really fluidly too. So that's really nice. And then you can attack diagonally too. So check this out. If I turn on the debug boxes, this is your standard attack. And when I move diagonally, you kind of get this diagonal box upwards. And same thing for moving lower right. You got some different attack boxes. So you got a lot more control over what you can, what your, you know, your items and stuff. Let me show you something. The top hat is another great example of diagonal movement. Oh, I do have the top hat already. Nice, right on, Kyle. Cool, man. Well, have a good day. I hope you're hope everything's going well for you. And yeah. The next version will be much, much cooler than the alpha. I promise. Oh, looks like I broke that too. Well, a lot of things to fix today. Oh well, let's get started. Okay, oh, you know what? The hat also has a behavior, so it's probably why that's working. All right, man. It's a proximity mine hat. Nice. Such a duper. Okay, so the behaviors. Oh, I forgot to even add them. Oh, duh. Okay, so anything that gets loaded with a profile name, these two methods. This needs a behavior. So we'll grab the behavior from the profile. And check it before adding it. Duh. This will fix a lot. This will probably fix the top hat and the enemies. There's this one other thing too. There's a special case for boomerang style. Entities that basically use a special mood function instead of a behavior tree, which is kind of janky. Shouldn't really be this way. I should convert all of my old mood code into behavior code. But for now, I've kept all these old moods because I can do really specific code stuff with moods. So, but it is kind of lazy of me to not have done that. But anyways, if boomerang, create an AI component with boomerang out, boomerang in. Other than that, I think that should create. We got dialogue, attack, health, move, input, collision. Yeah. Okay, let's hope it all works now. Right, if it does, then all these guys, yeah, all right, they're moving again. And they have good, they have moods. I mean, behaviors are running. Like the hat's still broken. So I'll figure that out. What happened to the hat? Okay. There's a method that creates a top hat. Maybe not. Oh, it's start shot top hat. That's right. So attack system start shot. Pedro, sup, man? Estás? Is there a special case in here for top hats? No, there's not. I wonder how the top hat does its thing then. Wow, really? Yeah. Bem, I think. Help me learn this. Help me learn this. So, obrigado means thank you, right? This means and you, but estubem, this part, bem means good, right? Is that right? And estu, what's that? All? Bapu, look, he's got rack attack now. Oh, I'm fine. Estu. Oh, like estoy. Right, okay. Fine. Bem means fine. I got it. Okay. Obrigado. I got this new some new methods, Pedro, I was making to make it like I'm still on the data-driven thing, and I got all these new methods to create entities with even the most basic amounts of data. Like I could just send in a val tree and it would create a whole entity based on that val tree data. So what's really cool about that is, for example, I've got walls now. Walls can be created with from the world.txt thing. And so wall has some images that it uses, loads these from data. So the images for walls can easily be changed. But then also this, it actually parses out the collision category size of the entity right there. So there's no need to code that. Yo, KX, hello man, welcome. How you doing today? Happy today. So there's something wrong still with the top hat. And I'm gonna go where it creates a top hat. So what's up with the top hat? There must have been some special logic. I don't need that breakpoint. There it creates the top hat here. I swear there either it was a boomerang. Yeah, that's it. It's a boomerang. Okay, so this where does this thing call here it is down here. Okay, right here it creates the AI, and this should be creating a boomerang type behavior. So let's see what's going on there. Here it calls create being. Oh, you know what? Maybe create being is all messed up. No, it can't be. There's other beings that are being created fine. Right, create being calls create entity, which uses a profile, a position, and a live. Okay. So let's step into this method here. This is where it gets the profile. Here it creates the entity. I trust that that's working well. And it's this boomerang part we really need to pay attention to. Oh, you know what? I probably just didn't even set the boomerang flag in the top hat. Duh, bet you that's it. Oh nope, looks like I did do it right. Really? Oh nice. So you went to a dedicated GPU thing? Nice, right on. Yeah, I bet you that game is one that's really great to play at the highest resolution and frame rate you can. I mean, that this looks stunningly beautiful. So how are you liking it? How are you liking the actual gameplay? You know, besides the graphics, besides settings, like the actual game, how are you liking it? And like yeah. Yeah, and it also does not have a behavior, so that should be okay. We're adding the position. to the entity. Should be okay as well. Mechanics 10 of 10. Wow. Artwork 10 of 10. Hell yeah. Wow. This sounds like an epic game. Here's the most important part right here. Attributes.query for key, AI.boomerang. Story 100 of 10. Wow. Really? Whoa. Wow. Well, it says, okay, man. You're the second person in 2 days that's told me how awesome this game is. It sounds like I'm going to have to buy it. So, you know, I'm down. I love my Metroid style. Metroid. All right, so the voucher we found. Boomerang, Valiant 1. Okay. Boomerang, true. Now, behavior should be null, which it is. If boomerang, entity, add component, new AI component, boomerang. Okay, this thing is fine. It's fine with this boomerang. Oh, it's not like Metroid, though. Okay. That's an important thing to note, because I thought this was a Metroid-style game. What does auto do? It just means it determines the type of the variable based on what it's created with. So if I were to go like this, auto I equals 1. Here, auto is an int. If I were to go auto j equals 2.0f, here auto is a float. Auto c string equals blah, 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 blah. Auto, here auto is a const char star. You got it? Crazy. Awesome. Yeah, I really gotta, you know what? I gotta check this out even further, because last night, I think I put it on my wish list, but I forgot to save a link to this on my desktop so I could check this out in more detail. Damn. Boogie, what's up, man? Yo, yo. Ah, crazy. Yep, I think I'm going to buy it, start playing it this weekend. All right, it looks like it already has a boomerang. So what the hell? E, there we go. Okay, so E... Yeah, no problem. It's got... Oh, that's the problem. It starts with mood boomerang in. Ah. Oh, this is... So there's a big... There's two... There's... Const char star is a C string. Okay. This is a pure C style string. Actually, let me put it really simply. All that is three characters in an array with a zero character at the end. So in total, that's four characters. All right, it's a very simple thing. It's a plain old data type. in C that you can use. String, however, which is actually standard string, is something totally different. This actually is a class. It has tons of great. So this is a C++ basically, right? And this is basically the C version. C++ version has so much stuff that you can do, like string size, string.length. In contrast with the C string, you would need to call string length on C string. You get me? It's basically C versus C++. Awesome. Cool, Ori. Oh yeah, so the mood is boomerang in. There's the problem. Hopefully. Okay, so going back to area creation. What? So I don't know. I don't understand what changed. They would make the exact same code fail now. Well, let's find out. Yeah. Wow. Yeah, what's today's mission? I'm still working on data, and I've gotten a lot farther with it. So the world.txt is the thing I'm kind of working on. And last night, so I started working on actual entities to work. So I got all the entrance and the entrance on the in the dungeon, as well as entrances on the overworld to have separate bits of data. So this is all loaded from data now, and now walls are even being created from data. So not only can it load all the image names from data, but it also loads things like the collision category and the collision size and everything from data. So I'm still working on that because I'll be really close to actually getting this new psychedelic dungeon working once I got a few more entities created. So I can make this come to life and actually see, you know, these little things wave in the wind and stuff, or in the whatever you call it. This is the prototype for their game. Awesome. I'll have to check that out later. All right, so there's a bug with the new code. There's something wrong with the top hat. It's not creating the save the right mood function. So the only thing I see so far, the difference between these is that this method has an intelligence and the other one doesn't, which could be a big difference. Active mood timer. Oh, delay timer. Direction, target, intelligence. Flags. Okay, well, there was a couple things missing there. All right, so this thing's available moods. We've got boomerang out. Good, that's the first one. Should be the first one. The next thing comes up. Push it back. We got out and in. D-Rand. No wonder. How is that ever working before? So DRAND is appropriate for some of these cases, but not at all when it's being initially created right here. This would be this set mood. This should be available moods. Yeah, dot size. Okay, if size is greater than zero, then set mood. Available moods first. J2, what's up? High five, man. Welcome to the stream. Available moves out front. Do we have it? We have a front. We have front. Okay, let's hope that the top hat is fixed now. Do you top at? Yeah. I've seen this one. Yeah. Oh no. Oh, what was that? I thought it was control bracket. It's not working. Dude, I swear it was control bracket or command bracket. Sorry about that. Yeah, I've seen this one. Oh man, what happened? Okay, I guess I'll go to AI component. Already there. Yeah, there's not. That's weird. Yeah, there is. There is like in Chrome and stuff, right? Could I describe the problem? Yeah, the top hat. It's just not going anymore. Since last night. So I'm not exactly sure what's wrong with it, but throw the top hat. Oh, it does come back. It just stays there. It doesn't go out. I guess maybe it's just moved out. Yeah. Yeah, it does open it directly, but then there's like a... It doesn't allow... It doesn't have the same window properties, but yeah. Yeah. Like it, if I open that window, right, I have to go there and resize it and stuff, but I guess it's not so bad. can't make it small. It's just, you know, it's just a totally different kind of thing. Oh, well. Minor things. It appears that the mood out is not working anymore. Boomerang out. Oh, no, this is in AI system. Safari, right? Yeah, I should switch back to Chrome. Oh, it could very well be the move component. Maybe it's just not, doesn't have speed. Let's find out. Yeah, why did they do that? Especially Microsoft, man. For how many years, how many decades did we have to deal with Internet Explorer? I mean, it's better now, right? Internet Explorer is kind of works now. Here we go. Move speed. Oh, it does have a move speed. Oh, but times the target's move speed. This could be the problem. Speed after this line's. Oh, no, that's fine. Oh, that's right. It is Edge. I forgot. But that's just since Windows 10, right? Shows you how much I know. My head's too much in this game to be in other games. Excel factor? It could be this. What's this thing? Yeah, Windows 10, right. What are you using, Boogie? Are you using Windows 10 or? Yeah, you are, right? Yeah, you're a Windows developer or on Windows, right? Could be timer over duration. Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Yeah, what's the timer and what's the duration? Well, duration's one. The timer, oh, this is gonna start. Starts at 1 second because it right, it gets it set. Okay, so Excel factor should be okay. This is gonna be 1/1 at first, which is one. And that should be perfectly fine to create a good acceleration factor. I mean, none of this code has changed, right? The only thing that's changed is the way that entities are created. Oh, wait a minute. Wait, how does it? So what are the components that are needed? Probably what happened is the components, there's some component that isn't getting created because like I just switched everything over to totally data driven. So there's probably some component that's not getting loaded from data right now. Could be input actually. Input component. It does not have an input component. Uh-huh. What's your take on Windows 10? How are you liking it? I'm thinking about upgrading my other partition on this computer from Windows 7 to Windows 10. You know what? That could be also okay. It does have a move mask. It does have collision. Input really is the only other thing this might need. Oh, that would totally make sense. Yeah, I bet you anything. If I just add an input component to this thing, it'll be all good. What's up? What? I have 10 is the best things in seven. You probably wouldn't, huh? Okay. 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 Thanks, you guys. Ready for graphics issues, huh? Maybe. Might be the speed that's not being applied. Maybe, I mean, but the thing is, I haven't changed any of that code recently. I've only changed the components. So I think it has something to do with components. Man, if I can't get this working in the next 5 minutes, I'm gonna switch to something else because this is not what I wanted to be doing today, is just fixing bugs. I wanted to get on to some creative stuff. We're starting the shot. Wrong button. The heck happened? Start shot. That's a tag system. So it creates an AI entity to represent the boomerangy top hat. There should be a point error. Here it is. Shot.ai.dir equals direction. So this is where it's setting the direction, and then the AI should be updating its direction. Okay, let's set a breakpoint there. Okay, so the shot, it should have an input component. And there's something, what is, there's in AI system or something which updates, applies input. Here it is, apply input. Yeah, and it requires an input component for movement. All movement requires this input component. So it's, it could be that the input component is not being created. So let's look at this shot. Is the entity that was just created input? Oh, it is active. It does appear that it created an input component. It's got a move component. Flags. Speed. Tom Nook, thanks, man. You mean you pre-ordered Songbringer? Jimmy, hello, welcome to the stream, man. I'm right in the middle of debugging a little issue with the top hat. And I'm at this point I'm kind of stumped as what's going on. I'll probably have to save this for later. Just figure it out. Cool. I really appreciate that, man. Thank you. And yeah, you get your name on the main menu and everything. So I'll be sending you an email. You'll get an email from me, and I'll ask you what you want, what name you want. Jimmy, you meant to the stream? Yep. I knew I've seen your name before. I was just saying welcome today to the stream. Let's see if that gets. Let's see if we even get to this point. It should be getting right here, and it should be applying the input based on this thing's compass direction. There. Oh, no worries. Okay, so the existing direction should be where we wanted this thing to start flying. Yeah, so the direction would be west. The two is west. And then it adjusts the direction. Oh. Fair enough. I see what the problem is. I forgot that input components, I can't just go input one and create an input component. I need to go input allow 8 compass directions or 4 compass directions or however many compass directions. So I'm going to put an assertion warning so I don't run into this again. Hey, what's up? Welcome to the stream, Akuma. Okay, that's easy enough. So in area creation, when it goes and it creates an entity, it goes and uses like let's assert something. Let's assert that input.get or count children. I think there's count or size. No, get. How do I count the children? Busy, huh? What you busy with? Get index has children. That's all I need. Has children. But it'd be nice to know how many children there are. I guess it's just minus, whatever. So assert, I'm gonna assert that this thing has children. There, so now I've got a nice warning so I don't make this mistake again. No, not necessarily. And yeah, AI component does not necessarily. Now I see what you're saying. Checking that, right? An AI component should have an input component. That's a good point. Let's make sure this works first, though. So I'll set that up and then run it. And this should give me an assertion failure now. Oh, looks like I changed a header. Whoops. 6 base level maps. Awesome, man. Yeah, there probably should be a few other things I should do here. Like, I guess AI should have a move component as well. Yeah, there we go. Okay, so I create the top hat. We should get an assertion failure. Can I create input component without children? Great. Okay, so that's clear. So I want to allow the top hat to move in all 8 directions. Yeah, that's what that recompile was. A check on all dependencies. Yeah. That's what I was just thinking too. Like what depends on what? That's what I was saying. I think an AI component also requires a move component. But that's really only for movement. Actually, yeah, no, the technically an AI component could be created without an input component and without a move component, without a health component, without any of these. Doesn't even AI component doesn't necessarily even need a collision component, but this does matter, you know, if it doesn't have the input, or if it does have the input, it needs to be at least specify what directions. Top hat works again. Oh, did it still get stuck? I don't know why it gets stuck on stuff. But I am not gonna debug too much right now. Oh, it probably gets stuck because it has an exit component. Move mask. No, it doesn't. There's no move mask whatsoever. That's weird. Just gonna check one more thing and make sure that the mask gets loaded for the boomerang. Yeah, I know I should, right? No, I gotta stop doing this. I'm still burnt out from the last time I did debugging. There we go. This thing should have no mask, and it doesn't. I don't know why it's getting stuck on those exits. Oh well. Later, I'll tackle that later. But the good news is, enemies and the top hat are now working again, so I can check this code in. A study of colors in games. So it just gives you like a spectrum almost of all the colors it uses. Interesting. This might be worth doing before the game's done. How long do I work each day? On average, 10 hours, 6 or 7 days a week. Even on days I don't stream, I still work on the game at least 8 hours. What's up, PMC? Okay, this is great. I'm glad these two bugs are fixed, and I don't want to do any more debugging today. So I'm gonna check this code in. Why is that just flag? Category, static, size, general, block size. This is more of like. Right, that's cool. Yeah, you like you gotta love Terminal ASCII art. That's really interesting. Avengers Age of Ultron. Wow, that's crazy. Oh, Akumo. Yeah, I don't mean for my work habits to influence yours, but this is just how much this game takes, man. This is a really, really long project for one person to do. And to I'm trying to squeeze it down to just 2 years. So, this normally would be like a 4 year project for multiple people. But yeah. So yeah, but just work however works good for you. That's my advice. Yeah, PMC, I've seen Buildbox. It's made by that guy from San Diego. It's a new game development app. No less than 60 months. Oh, 6 months. Oh, it was funnier with 60, man. Great, fix the top hat. Might have fixed some important bugs there too. Got all these new create entity methods, so I can create very basic create entities from data, very simply too. All right, we don't need this create entity. Yeah. Entertain us. More jokes. We require more jokes. Mead, a flagon of wine. Where did this go? That. Oh yeah, area creation. All right, so this is what I wrote all that code last night for, and I just did all this debugging now on the stream, was just to do this. This makes it so I can create an entity without having to do all that. I can specify what the entity should be like in data and then use this method. Oh, look at this streak. Streak. Boom. See that? I wrote like 1,000 lines of code just to replace three. No, I'm joking. I just refactored some old code. It was existing, already there. But that is going to come in handy later on to make things more data driven. More data driven. The data is driving it. There's one more area. Here, this function, don't need it no more. See ya, oldness. Right, wow, Mars is missing out. All right, next thing, next thing. So what that did is it made it so I got this. Boom, a wall can be loaded. So what's next? What is the next thing to do on this list? So I'm working towards getting this mock-up into the game, playable. I need to get other entities in the level, in the world inside the level and all that too. load from data. I do have one debate. I would like to say what this debate is so I can I don't mean to break the chain or anything, but I do need some thoughts here. I have two ways I could go about making entities the size of entities represented in data. Right now, this is what the block size is right now. Oh, sorry, I'm lost. Here we go. Yeah, so a block size is 20. This is the X, 12 by 12, the Y, and 16, the Z. Yeah. Nobody wants to be the person to ruin it. But thank you, PMC. Thank you, man. You're a hero. So yeah, here's one way I could do it. I could do 1 by 1 by 2, right? Or I could do it pixels. So this is in blocks, right? This would be this thing is one block by one block by one by two blocks. Or I could do it the other way and specify it all in pixels. So if anybody has any thoughts on that, I would love to get some thoughts because I'm debating. I think this one is probably the way to go. Yeah. Yeah, I don't know exactly right now, but we'll move on to doing some other stuff. So let's grab another entity. Let's change another entity into being data driven now. Let's do this. One more entity, the statue. Let's do the statue entities. These things are pretty simple, should be. So all of these entities, we'll get these loading from data. It looks like there might be multiple frames. No? No, I guess not. But it doesn't matter. Statues. Right? But the on the contrary to that, so yeah, that's a good point, but I've got the actual block size here in the data as well. Right. So if a person does write a mod for this game, they can specify their own block size. So the advantage to using block sizes is that you don't have to go re-specifying that all the time, right? So if you have a block size that's basically 20 by 12 in a 2D sense, then you never have to go type 2012. If you're gonna use that, if you're gonna use 2012 a lot, like you're gonna use a lot of blocks, it's probably easier to write just 1 1 or 0.8, 0.9 if you're gonna go less than a block, you know. Right? Okay. I was definitely leaning towards pixels last night, and then I realized that I would have to rewrite a lot of 2012s all over the place, and that it would kind of be easier to change the whole game. Let's say I wanted to go change the tile size at some point, and I want to change my tile size to be 25 or whatever. It'd be a lot easier to just change that one single 25 reference instead of having to go change every single pixel perfect thing in all the data. Right, I see what you're saying here. So if you have a collision block other than a sprite size, and it's not really. Say that again? Is this rely or really? Constants. Now that's an idea. Huh. Nah. Good thinking. Constants might actually be the way to go. And then, so then it would be something like you could specify constants, like there would be whatever. Actually, yeah, let's call this instead of defaults, let's call that constants. Rely, okay. So block, yeah, so let's say a constant is block size, or it would be more something like block size x. So like block x would be 20, block y would be 12, block z 16, and then later, and then here it would be 1 times block x, 1 times block y, 2 times block z. Although that is kind of getting cumbersome. That's the one thing that is kind of cumbersome. But it is a little clearer. The thing is, this is kind of not as clear what's going on. Ah, what a debate. What a debate. That almost makes you want to just stick with pixels. Huh. I don't know which way to go here, so I'm just gonna make things more data-driven for other stuff. It's the statues. Start with statues. So create statue tile. Right? Yeah, I definitely would. Especially for modders, especially for me. Yeah, I definitely do not want to do anything that's going to be cumbersome, because that's just, you know, it detracts. The thing is, this should be easy and clear. Yeah. Create statue tile. Render component. All right, this thing has a, okay, this thing has a collision component of static 2020. Okay, so let's create a new entity. This is an entity called statue. Images, we'll put some in here, but collision, category static, this thing is size 20 by 20, and this thing's pretty, these are pretty tall. This would be something like 20 by 20 by 48 or so. Ooh. Pixels, blocks, oh, what am I going to vote? My instinct is to say blocks. Oh, my God. I don't know. Oh. Oh, wow. Look at that. Unanimous voting so far. This thing has a shadow. So we can go shadow one. That'll give it a shadow component. This part here is, this is, might be tricky a little bit. Abstain. No vote for me. Peanut butter. That's your civic duty. All right, this thing puts a prefix. And then the name, and then a rand index behind it. Prefix is something like zero. And is the get flag number, right. Okay, so this images. This thing needs a percent D in it, so maybe we'll call this format. Oh, that now that's I like this. Let's take a look at that. Yeah, like PX. Right, right. So instead of this, it would be like one block. So 1B, 1B, 2B. Yeah, that's actually really nice. That's pretty simple, right? And then this is you could have both. You could either do pixels and just leave them all like that. Or if you really want to, you could just do 1B, 1B, 2B, or even like 1.3B, you know, or whatever. That's cool. Great idea, J2. Much better than doing like all that. Cool. So this thing's format. Let me see the actual images it has for the statues. We got zero statue, zero. That's it. There's no two statue. Or there's one statue, zero. Two statue, zero. Oh, two statue, zero. Oh, that's on the overworld. Overworld version. Really, this is going to need to break down into statue dungeon and also a statue. Two blocks is the winner with three votes. Cool. I like this. I like the hybrid though. The hybrid suggestion is really awesome. All right, this is totally doable, man. Totally doable. So, for example, what dungeon is this? Stone. This one would be statue dungeon would be one statue percent D dot ping. That's it. And then I need to load different data based on whether it's a level. Yeah, similar to this, how this thing works. So we get the data based on if it's a level or not. So if this is a level, we're gonna load entities.statueDungeon. And if it's otherwise, we're gonna be on the overworld and we're gonna do get data, get flag number based on the current area's flags. So we'll get the, like, this is level one or whatever, and then query that for entities.statue. So statues on the overworld, statue dungeons in the dungeon. Hey, Beetlejay, welcome, man. Okay, and then we're gonna load some stuff from this data. We're not gonna need a prefix anymore. That's cool. I love to get rid of code Such a good thing. And here, this is going to get way easier as well. The render component, the only thing it's going to change is this last bit where we set the flip X for the sprite. What? Huh? What you saying here? Hmm. Okay. So this would be entities pushback entity area create entity. We have data. We also have a name for the image. And a position. I just noticed something. I think I forgot to put image file name. No, I didn't, huh? This is all good. Well, okay, so the data is just data. Image file name, we're going to do a kit string format. We might need to actually, we can just go, data dot get or query. This is gonna be images dot format get string. And if this thing, thanks for following. If we have an image file name size, then we can proceed with the rest of this. So image file name. And we're passing in the one number. What's the one number again? R. That's the random number for which where does it get? There's nothing that ever mods that number. That's weird. It should be modding that number by the number of, and it doesn't. Look at that, it doesn't mod it at all. It's weird. R. It's static as well. Am I just totally missing something here? Where does it cycle the R? Well, this is something to pay attention to. And then the last thing to do is to get this thing's render component. Set the flip X, because that can't be done with data. This is random at runtime code based, so gotta be done after we call this awesome convenience method. Okay. And we'll figure out what's up with R here in a second. The data that got passed in? Oh, it looks all right. Good. Statue dungeon. Some images. All the other stuff. We got one statue two, one statue three, one statue four. Look at that. See? R never, ever, ever. And none of them worked. But they all have collision boxes. That's good. That two statue one. Wait, two. Oh. No, one statue. All I have is one statue zero. I guess I could load the animation. One statue one. Yeah, the first one should be one statue zero. Probably a better way to do this is to do. Get an animation. Based on this format. And then mod this by the number of frames. There. One statue zero. One statue zero. Good. All right, we got statues again. Okay, and now that it's data driven, we could easily go and change this to be like zero statue percent D, and that's totally flexible. It could have as many frames as it wanted in that the number of statues. And look at this. Now we got these statues here, and it's automatically using all four of those different images. Sweet. Yes, another thing, data driven. It's got the right size, the right category. They should have shadows. Oh, color as well. Do they have shadows? Yeah, these have shadows. Got some slight flickering shadows there. Okay, so let's apply the color as well. This will be. Render equals that. If render isn't empty, okay. So, yeah, I guess that is a little bit longer than it was before, but having it being data driven is worth it. Oh, color. Color could be easily specified. Yeah, there we go. These colors look a lot better. Still doing okay here. Look at that. Game show's running good today. Okay, actually, color could be specified in data as well, or which color type to use at least. So we start off with white. This is the one in particular that I'm looking at. This is like screaming at me. It needs to be data driven. And that's not too hard. For example, the goldeny ones. Okay, let's create the same kind of thing for statue dungeon. Wait, first of all, let's go to level 2. And at this point, we have no statues and no statue entities or anything. But this thing does have some statues. So let's create them. I believe that's 2 statue. Same collision categories, fine. Shadow. Oh man, this is so awesome. Could change anything per dungeon. Oh, sweet, dude. Good job, Boogie. So you made your own sprite sheet packer. Yeah, dude. That's a cool tool to build, man. Good for you. Yeah, dude. P-list and all. What's up, Lithune? Howdy, howdy, man. I'm in the process of making the game more data-driven, which is going to make it be able to create levels and stuff faster. You know, last week or whatever, I've created this mock-up image for this boss fight here. And ever since I created this, I'm like, man, I need a better way to specify this stuff in data rather than in code. And so I've been on that mission for a minute, but getting close. Fatalfinstad, what do I think of Unity? I think it's amazing. It's a great tool. It's a great, great, amazingly good engine. So now that we added a statue dungeon type, we should have statues now in this dungeon. Yes, and we do. Okay, now the next thing I want to do is using color types. So this bit of code right here is just really ugly, right? It's specifying to use a certain color type based on a certain dungeon number. That's all wrong. Yeah, cool. Ori's made in Unity. Yeah. Ah, right. Yeah. Texture packer's $50 now? It was like $20 when I bought it, or back in the day, this thing used to be $20. Gosh, that really changes. $50 is pretty expensive for a piece of software. I mean, yeah, it is like essential, but where do you, store? Okay, so it's $40. But still, $40 is twice what it used to be. Yeah, Big Data World. Texture Packer is written in pure C. Cool. Yeah, I've respected him for a while. We've kept in contact. This is, back in like 2010 or whatever. We were in a lot closer contact. But what's his name again? Andreas. Andreas. Oh no, Unity's written in pure C. Wow, I never knew that. Did they ever upgrade the UI for Unity yet? Like, what's the new 5 version? Did they change the UI at all? That's the one thing I was like, when I was using Unity, it was version 4, the last one I used. And the UI was like kind of old school, I thought, but still, it's still a great tool. Yeah, they did change it a bit. Okay, so I want that color to come through in this thing's render. At first, we shouldn't have anything. That shouldn't work. I don't think I've hooked up the color yet. Whoa, did that work? What's up, Lime? What's being data-driven right now are the statues. Yeah, slowly but surely working to in the so like I've got this little definition for statues, for example. Flood, what's up, man? How you been? Weetabit, what's up? Haven't seen your name in a while. Hope you're doing good, dude. How does your entity system work? Is it all component-based? Yes. How do you identify each entity type? There's no such thing as an entity type in an entity component system. There are only component types. But how would I identify each? I'm not sure what you mean by that. But you can check out my whole entity component systems on GitHub. Oh, it's here. Check it out. Oh, that's not it, huh? Entity. Oh, entity foo. Right there, man. You bought a car? Wow. Nice, man. Yeah, things are going good here, too. I don't think that color was setting the actual color there. It didn't. Okay. Yes, essentially. Yeah. The way at least this the entity component system, entity foo, works is that an entity is simply just a single integer. That's all an entity actually is. There's components that are kept in a component array, and you can add components. You can theoretically you're adding a component to the entity, but really the entity is just a single integer that represents what, like for example, components are all stored in an array and I'm getting too technical here, I think. Yeah, just check out if you check out entity foo here, it might help to look at the code. But please ask any more questions if I'm not making it clear enough or if I didn't answer that right. You can't see straight, but you can't stop playing it. Cool, man. Awesome. Rocket Bunny, what's up, yo? Howdy, everybody. Yeah, ask away, Weetabix. Hope I'm not hope I was making sense there. Render component now? Render component, if it's initialized with data, we can set a color easily. Color. So I'm gonna grab get child color get stir. Wow, yeah, 71% map, 50%. You're doing great on your items. Yeah, I know. Did the stream crash? I hope not. It is. For real. Says it's okay here. We're back. Oh, all right. All right. What's up with that? What's going on? No, this probably has nothing to do with anyone. It's just Twitch. It's gotta be Twitch. Yay! Autocomplete. Come on, autocomplete. You can do it. Oh, look at that. I was so lazy. I didn't even want to type a Z and an E, so I waited all that time. Here we go. Sprite set color. RGB color. Yes, now we can set colors with data. Yeah, I'll let him share his amazing news. Color, here we go. Let's set some wild, random, crazy color so we can make sure that it's working. Oh, it didn't work. Womp Render color. Well, did it get this far? It did. Yeah. It's getting most of the way here. Oh, duh, I overrode it right here. This is going to need a color type. And this part, this is kind of some special code which sets the color. Yeah. So it would be something like this: auto color equals render dot sprite dot get color, and then no, we don't need that. We just need render dot sprite dot set color HSV dot to RGB. Now we don't need color. Don't need this. And don't need this either. This can be converted to a color type. Oh, let me clarify on that too. It was, you know, it's hard to put a lot of information into a direct message or a tweet or whatever. But there's this this article. Oh man, I hope I can find this article. Gamma Sutra Marketing Indie Game Marketing Evil Corporation. No. Oh man, I don't know if I'm gonna find this. How not to market in your indie game? This might be it. No, this is not the one. Why do I like pixelated games? Because it conveys that it is a video game. When you look at a 3D game, sometimes you can wonder, especially with today's games, you can wonder, is this a movie or is this a game? And so to me, looking at pixels says, oh no, instantly, that's a game. And secondly, it's kind of a nostalgic thing. I love the old retro look. I think it just looks super cool. Especially with 32-bit like 32-bit colors, today's colors with old style pixels, this looks really cool to me. Like, for example, Sword and Sorcery. That's just a great example of that kind of art. So, anyways, I think it looks great, and I think it conveys the fact that it's a game. Uh-huh. Yeah, there's that too. Imagination. But there's this article somebody wrote on Gamma Sutra about basically I'll paraphrase what the article was saying. The article is saying that most gamers think that corporations are evil. So when they see something like a game coming out and it says, oh, this is the new game from Ubisoft or whatever, they're going to say, oh, Ubisoft. But if they say this is a new game from John Doe from down the street, they're going to be much more interested in it because it's not some evil corporation that's trying to shove something down their throats or market something to them. Gamers are notorious for that type of behavior where they look and see corporations as evil, you know. But that's kind of paraphrasing this guy's article. And it was a great article. I wish I could find it. Yeah, the game's coming great. Vlad, you'd probably really respect this. I'm making everything data driven now. So like even the smallest entities, like just a statue or whatever, has its data, like its file format loaded from data, its collision size, category, whether it has, you know, certain components, everything is going to be loaded from data now. Lycan, what's up, Lycan? Yeah. See, and I'm not doing a very good job of saying how, what his article said. So I'm probably missing some really important points here, you know. Yeah, I wish I could have found that article. Yeah, right. And that totally depends on, yeah, what type of, you know, what your opinion is about corporations too. So the last thing we need is to get that to work. Color types. Yeah, cool. It worked. So now we have some bright pink statues. And if I change this color to something else, oops. Yeah, overdoing it's very dangerous. You have to draw the line somewhere. Yes, 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 yes. Highly agree with this. And I realized that when I looked at all my code already for creating entities, I'm like, dude, there's no way I could go and change all of this into data because it would be, there's too much actual stuff that really needs code to run here. For example, I mean, yeah, I can go and I could comment out like all this stuff I've gotten rid of. Yes, but some of it I can't get rid of. There's some really important stuff that needs to remain code. So I thank you for that warning. And I'm not going to overdo this, but I do think it's going to be freaking awesome to be able to have modders of people playing this, you know, modding this game, easily be able to change stuff. And especially I'm doing it because it's going to make it easier for me to make new dungeons. So once I've got a single dungeon set up, you know, then I can easily go and copy it, paste it, change all the art, and create, you know, a brand new dungeon in like a day rather than doing a brand new dungeon in a week or something. So it should be worth it. But I agree. There's a line that has to be drawn. Pinkbert. My God, my phone is blowing up. How's the mock-up? Hey, it looks cool, man. I want to see a character. Is there but unless there's no character in your game. Oh, there's a character. Oh, there he is. Cool, man. What's he got? Has he got a gun that's like floating? It's cool. Do you want any suggestions? Let me know if you want suggestions. Oh. Yeah, I mean, it looks great. Yeah, feedback. Do you want feedback? Let's try and set a color type now for this. Yeah, so my only suggestion there was to maybe change your characters, a little bit of the colors in your character to make it more distinct from the background. So you've got this. This is a great looking image to start with, right? I love the muted tones and the desaturated look of all this. And I like how your colors are pretty complementary, and you did a great job, especially your background tiles here are looking really nice and faded. So everything's looking really good. The one thing I think would help is if your character had slightly different colors from everything else. So maybe just a single bit of color, like his eyes. Maybe if his eyes were a different color, you know, or his head or something. I like your silhouette look, though. The silhouette is always a classy, beautiful thing to do, but That's just my two cents. Right? Isn't that funny? Yeah. So color type rock is what it's supposed to be, but let's assume radical, like changing this to be color type water so we can see that it's actually doing it. I think I'm already processing color type somewhere. Guess not. Okay. So let's see. Render component. Color type. Yeah, it is. Yeah, I hear you. I hear you on that one. I've noticed that too about Axiom Verge. He In Axiom Verge, it is really beautiful art, right? Yeah, it does hurt. It does hurt because he doesn't put enough con he doesn't put enough saturation difference, I don't think, from the background to the foreground. Like there's so many areas where I was playing Axiom Verge and I got into the area and I ran straight into an enemy because I'm like, God damn, I didn't even see that that was an enemy versus the background because it's just the background and that are the same saturation values and everything. But it might be that he's actually that's intentional, you know, because it is kind of a really explory type game where you're trying to look for secrets and stuff and he's trying to hide things, but I don't know. Ah, bad access. Yeah, right. Yeah, you yeah, it looks like sounds like we both experienced it, huh? Yeah, right. Yeah. Yeah, I noticed that too. So let's process the color type. Process by calling parse flags using the string and words color types. Man, dude, autocomplete's so slow. And here's where we need to actually grab the area as well. Or we just go world area. World area. Get color. Yeah, I've heard of Downwell. But I forget which one it is. Let me refresh my memory. Oh, wow. No, I don't think I've seen this one. Looks pretty rad though. Yes, gun boots. Sweet. I gotta try this. It's only $3. Oh, I know, right? That was super cool. Oh, I know. I was like, damn, I kind of want that. Yeah. Simple concept too. It looks more like a mobile game though than a. Is it endless dungeons, like an endless thing or something? Here we go. Okay, let's see if that worked to parse a color type. And this needs to use the current area. So I think that would be fine. Yeah, it is very trippy, right? Yeah. Super trippy. It took me like 20 hours to finish it the first time. I'm on my second run right now. There's a lot of content in that game. And there's so many secrets. Have either of you guys found any secret worlds? Yeah, cool. It did. It parsed it right. K color water. And this would, let's see if it gets the color correctly. Yeah. Color is type. Bam. No problem. Okay. So that should work. Nice. You did? You found two of them? Whoa. Oh my God. You found one too? Oh, dude, you guys are rad. No, I haven't. Distance? What's that? Yeah, check it out. It worked. So these are now blue from the watercolor. Okay, great. Data-driven colors. But really, this thing is supposed to be that color. And then color type water should be reserved for these other ones in the first dungeon. Oh, color type rock should be there. And now we don't need any of this stuff anymore. Keep track of an R, that's okay. We don't need the flag number. This thing is done elsewhere now. Golden. Colored rock, all that stuff. Okay, and this. If image.file name.size, don't have that. This whole method is bunk anyway, so. That used for? Yeah, nice. Oh, it looks smoother now, you mean? The gameplay or something? Or the frame rate? Oh, it's like a, oh yeah. I saw this on Twitter today. Yeah, especially that right there. I saw this GIF where a car was flipping. Looks cool. But it's a survival racing game, huh? Looks pretty cool. Yeah, it might be that I'm actually using some different settings now for the stream. So it's probably just that. Oh, hi Ollie. What's up, Ollie? How you doing, Ollie? Yeah. You're welcome. So this is all some custom stuff. Right? This is meant to be code. Oh, this door can be down here. All right, yet another method is done. Yeah, F0 for sure. Yeah, you like Fallout 4? Cool. We got another thumbs up for Fallout 4. We got mixed reviews on Fallout 4 so far from people mentioning it on the stream. I think this is done. Statue dungeon. Oh, the next thing it needs to be is statue overworld or the regular statues. So if I go up to, like, let's put the player back to one, and then we'll go back up to the overworld, and we should have some statues that should be missing at first. What about static R? I did it that way just because I wanted them to be sequential. Bugs all over the place. But yeah, okay, so this is where we need to make sure these statues are working. So they're not working just yet, but we can get them to. Ink, huh? What's ink? Oh, Zach Bell? Oh right, yeah, I saw his tweets about this game a while ago. Looks really interesting. Yeah, it's very, very colorful, right? Very beautiful game. Damn. Game show is going crazy again. It just starts using a bunch of CPU. It's like I might be at my limit, you guys. But let's do a little more. Come on. Come on, come on, come on. So the statues on the overworld, these things. Oh, these need to be one. These could be zero. Color type rock is probably okay. Yeah, you hate him for making it so hard. Yay! It's share game night. Yeah, it's my freaking fan, right? I know. It's annoying. But and that's my fan because look at Game Show. Game Show is just eating it up. It was fine until a second ago. But yeah, let's prove this is all looking good. Like if we change the color type, whoops, this color type here to water, we should have something totally different. See? But this is so cool. Just enough stuff loaded from data, not too much stuff. Let's put that back to rock, and let's do another thing. Like, we can change the size. It can make them really, really big, like 200. No, that's too big. Too much. Maybe like 80 by 80. This will make huge static, huge tiles for these. You found it? What'd you find? Yeah, check it out. Now we have just gigantic statues. Death cars. Oh, that's the game it reminded you of? All right, well, I'm going to check this in, and that's going to be about it for the stream. So we got, I hit the 2-hour limit, and game shows looks like it's hit its limit here. So, get status, check this out. Yeah, constants, probably not constants, but this is great. One more method, one more entity is now a really good combination of data-driven and code. Great, I love it. Statues, data-driven. Do you have a liquid-cooled desktop? Whoa! Yeah, I know, I would love to. Yeah, I would love to. I'd love to at least have 2 monitors, if not 6 monitors. But oh yeah, all right, so that's it for the stream today. Sorry I wasn't really playing the game much or making art today. It was mostly just a programming day, but well worth the programming. This was going to come in very handy over the next year of developing this game. Being able to specify all this stuff in data. So tonight I'm going to go back and start working on more or keep on working on stuff. Like, for example, I'll probably work on these pillars to get these to load from data as well. And then door types also would be an amazing thing to load completely from data. So slowly but surely. Nice. Yeah. See you guys. Have a good night.